Those born in the 90s or earlier will likely recognize this sound. I previously discussed the importance of the phonograph in my video titled The Invention That Changed Music. But there's another era of recording technology that seems to have gotten lost in the hustle and bustle of an industry that is constantly evolving. The era of magnetic recording. Hi everyone, and welcome to Music Theories, where I explain and analyze all topics related to music. Be sure to subscribe for more content, especially if you're a music geek like me. Aside from giving myself a shameless plug, it's a good idea to watch the video that I mentioned previously before watching this one. It won't be required knowledge in regards to this video, but they're both parts of a sort of mini-series that I'm making, and it'll be worthwhile to know all of the background info. Just a quick disclaimer, I'll be covering these topics at a surface level relative to the amount of information one could study on these technological advancements. We know that the creation of the flat disc impacted America in a huge way. So significantly, in fact, that many generations today who are far removed from vinyl records, including myself, tend to collect them. Even though some argue that the cassette has a better sound quality than vinyl, it's more rare to meet somebody who collects cassette tapes. Why do we think this is? Of course, I do believe in order to understand this progression, we have to go back to the beginning. The idea of sending sound signals through magnetic conductors was an idea that had been explored many times before, by the likes of Nikola Tesla, Oberlin Smith, and Valdemar Poulsen in the late 19th century, the most notable being Poulsen's telegraphone in 1898. The telegraphone was similar to the phonograph in that it used a rotating cylinder to record sound, but where the phonograph had wax or tinfoil, the telegraphone had steel wire, and where the phonograph had a needle, the telegraphone had a magnet. The sound could then be played back as an electrical current through the same mechanism. Though the machine was proven to be way ahead of its time, that was also its demise in the early 20th century. The telegraphone was prone to breaking down, and at the time couldn't compete with the sound quality and performance of the disc recorders and the record industry. It was forgotten by the public for the next few decades, until the invention of DC bias and later AC bias. However, that doesn't mean that the potential of the technology was completely lost on those of the time. After an attempt to utilize the telegraphone in military strategy in World War I, German engineers led the efforts to improve the technology as World War II was brewing. Dr. Kurt Stiles, a German entrepreneur, improved upon the telegraphone and marketed the patent rights to both British and German companies. It was called the Echophone. Stiles eventually merged with another company, International Telephone and Telegraph, to become C. Lorenz AG, and sold many different magnetic recording devices to the Nazi government. The biggest issue that these companies were having with the magnetic recorders of the time was the practicality of the materials required to run the machine. Steel wire that was extremely difficult to repair if it came undone, and ribbon made of steel that was a bit too hardy for accurate recordings, were just not the most suitable materials. Around the same time, the Berlin company AEG began collaborating with German-Austrian engineer Fritz Flumer and another company, BASF. Flumer had come up with the idea to create paper tape coated in iron oxide, which today is known as the first tape recorder, the sound paper machine. Fritz and AEG combined ideas for new reinforced magnetic tapes that could be played on a motorized machine, which they eventually sold as the magnetophone. By this point, the value of this technology was being recognized beyond the scope of military strategy. Radio stations were looking to capitalize on the quality of the magnetic recording, and over the years, the machines were improved upon by various engineers in Britain, the United States, and Japan. But the German magnetophone still reigned supreme, since it was portable and it was self-contained with an amplifier and speaker. Major John T. Mullen, an electrical engineer in the American Signal Corps, was assigned to investigate the radar interference in Britain during the war. He often wondered how full orchestras would be playing symphonies through all hours of the night as he listened to high-quality German radio broadcasts. These broadcasts were similar to live broadcasts and better than the playback of shellac records. Once he finally discovered the secret on a trip to Radio Frankfurt, magnetophones with AC biasing, he shipped two of these machines home to study the circuitry. He improved upon and demonstrated them to the Institute of Radio Engineers in San Francisco in 1946, who recommended that Mullen work with the Ampex Electrical and Manufacturing Company. They eventually came out with the Magnatrack, which was first contracted to record the Philco radio show starring Bing Crosby in 1947. Bing Crosby prepaid Ampex and Mullen $50,000 to expand their Model 200A tape recorder prototype, which was adopted by radio stations and officially distributed by Bing Crosby Enterprises on the West Coast. By 1948, the American tape recorder industry was firmly established and would be used for motion pictures, computers, and of course, music. An issue that recording technology had in general, even outside the realm of magnetic recording, was the sheer size of the technology itself. Tape recorders for consumers had become available via the innovation of companies in the US, Britain, Germany, Japan, and Switzerland. But even so, they weren't particularly convenient. Sony's first tape recorder was over 100 pounds. Even the recorders that were portable weren't easy to transport. Many companies had attempted to minimize the size of the tape, resulting in many products that fell short in sound quality and really functioned as a toy more than anything else. By 1964, RCA and Ford had adopted a machine created by Earl Muntz and William Lear called the 8-track. This machine remained popular from the mid-60s through the entirety of the 70s. Cars had even been modified to include these right on the dash, which for the time was innovative and exciting. However, as exciting as they were, 8-tracks were still too big to fit in your pocket. So again, we have portable but not compact. Holland ended up being the one with the solution to this problem in 1965, which would ultimately make the 8-track player obsolete in the early 1980s. The Philips company came up with a portable, compact audio tape recorder and playback machine, with a compact cassette to go with it, similar to the original version Edison had for the phonograph. Philips' intention was that this product would be for business dictation. They were totally unaware that they had just created a simple way for consumers and artists to record music. Philips did, however, make the patent free for use, which not only allowed the cassette tape recorder to dominate over other mediums, but also allowed for many different companies to continue to improve upon the technology, elevating the cassette player from a toy to a legitimate music recording machine. The compact cassette had a smaller cartridge at only a quarter the size of other cassette systems, a twin hub structure that prevented tape jamming and improved tape running, the potential for superior sound quality and performance, careful development approach of sales and access to consumer feedback, was compatible with mono and stereo, unlike open reel systems, and above all else, a free patent license. Philips hadn't intended for the patent to be free, but ultimately made the decision as a business power move to beat out their competition, the DC International format, which was going to be pushed by Sony. From there, with Japan at the forefront, the cassette tape continues to advance in many small but significant ways. The science and innovation involved in these advancements are things I couldn't even begin to cover in a short video series. I encourage you to read more about these things if you're interested in the minor details. Around the same time, radio stations had begun to broadcast high-quality sound recordings on what were called FM stations. The average consumer was particularly drawn to FM broadcasting, mostly because the quality rivaled that of vinyl LPs, which were quite expensive to purchase at the time. The bulkiness and price of a family radio system, coupled with growing popularity of the cassette format, created a desire for devices that were of a smaller scale. This ushered in what is considered the golden age of the Japanese audio industry in the 70s and 80s. The first breakthrough for the young generation was the appearance of the radio cassette, a device that was capable of transmitting FM stations and recording on a compact cassette. This allowed average listeners to record the hi-fi audio they heard on the FM radio right to their personal cassette and play it back repeatedly. This was a very important step in the direction of personalized audio, and people began to grow their own collections of music mixes on cassettes. These devices continued to develop, with higher quality stereo and double cassette players, and eventually compact discs. In the video about the phonograph, we discussed the importance of having music at home in a world where it was only accessible in a live setting. The phonograph created the demand for music in the living room. The radio created the demand for music in other rooms of the house and in the car. And the radio cassette player created the demand for music outside of the house and the car. Music, anytime, anywhere. This brings us to a very important piece of music history. The Walkman. The Walkman, released by Sony in Japan in 1979, could not record, but in exchange, it fit right in your pocket and came with your very own pair of headphones. The Walkman made its way to the US and the UK under some not-so-successful name changes. And though there was a bit of doubt in the necessity for a machine that plays but doesn't record, it quickly became a massive global success under its original name. This was such an important shift in music culture, and like the phonograph, essentially altered the way we listened to music entirely. Music would continue to be more compact, more personalized, and collections themselves would become more portable. By the time Walkmans became mainstream in the early 1980s, digital audio was creeping up on the tape recording methods and would soon take over entirely, but that is a topic for another time. The cassette tape stands as an icon for multiple generations of music lovers and seriously helped pave the way for music listening as we know it today. Be sure to subscribe to see the next part in this series and more music history and analysis videos in general. Feel free to leave topic suggestions in the comments, and of course, thank you for watching.